Hey, I'm Greg Ayers, and you're watching the Fans POV.
And are you an officially licensed maid?
You know, I could have gone up, I could have gotten my certificate, and I'm not quite sure if that would have been a particularly proud moment for me, though.
So why don't you tell everyone what you're dressed as and everything like that?
Well, currently I am dressed as the Bat from the Superman Red Sun comic book.
How's Comic-Con compared to, like, the AVN Awards?
You know, it is so much bigger.
Would you permit us to draw a dick somewhere on your clothing?
Yeah.
So if you...
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Fans POV. I am Ernie Layug, joined along with Miss Krissy Lawlor. We are talking about DragonCon this year. DragonCon. Yes, it's been a long time coming. We've heard about this convention for about 3 years now.
Wanted to go last year, couldn't.
Yeah, we couldn't go last year, so we saved up, and now we are here in Atlanta, Georgia, for the convention itself. So, first things first, let's go on to first impressions of the con. Krissy, what did you think of DragonCon?
Well, first impression, it's huge. The venue is just huge, multiple hotels, and I was just surprised by that size. I thought it was just one big giant convention center. But I was just amazed by how many people that can actually fit in those buildings and all the stuff that's going on.
Yeah, I definitely just the size and the magnitude behind it, because it's five hotels, and each of them at least had to be, I think, one packed, and number two, at least 30 floors worth of hotel rooms.
Oh, yeah.
So it was up there. Like, you look up and you can see, you saw it on our day three update, just all of us just looking up at, like, just the sheer size of the Marriott. And also just, like all the people there, they said that over 40,000 showed up. There's got to be more than 40,000 this year.
Definitely. That had to be more than 40,000. Because it looked more than half. It looked a lot more than Otakon, and I doubt... And Otakon's like 30. There was more than that there.
Oh, yeah. There was definitely a lot more at this one. And it's also with this one is that it's a wide variety, and we'll go into a little bit more of that later, because it's not just science fiction, it's not just anime, like what we're used to. It's a whole bunch of other tracks that they have. So we will go into that. So those are our first impressions of it. Now... expectations. We had some expectations when we were coming into this convention here in Atlanta, and the first thing was, from what we've heard from Voltaire, we heard from Emerald Rose, we heard of people at the Renaissance Fair.
Friends who've been to DragonCon before.
Yeah, exactly. Friends who've been here. They say that this is just one big party. What do you think about that?
Definitely. Maybe not in certain areas of certain hotels you couldn't see it, but if you went to other areas, you could see it. Like when me and Chris went to one of the Emerald Rose performances, they were just, oh, not the Emerald Rose, me and Tom went to the Firefly drinking song.
Sing-along.
There were people there with beers, wine. Everybody was just walking around with drinks, just having a blast. It was like, and who's coming from what bar to go into what panel, from what bar to what bar. It was just, everyone was partying.
Oh, yeah, it was like the one big party. It's also with those five hotels, it's within a mile radius of each other. So wherever there were bars, and it was the downtown area, so you had a lot going on. There's a Hard Rock there, there's a Hooters there, there's some... I know there's some other places nearby there, but it was just like, it just went from bar to hotel, everywhere.
Well, a lot of the hotels themselves had multiple bars.
Oh, yeah, especially some of the...
Like the Hyatt, Hyatt and the Marriott each had.
Oh, yeah, they definitely did, yeah. They definitely had more than one bar. And the funny thing is that with the some of the hotels, they set up bars in, like, the lobby area. So that way, if you want a drink, you just go down there and... They'll have some drinks ready for you. So that was one thing there. Another thing was, we touched upon it earlier, was the crowds. And we were saying that this was all, it wasn't really Otakon size, because I remember Otakon was packed. Over 33,000 attended that one. This one, last year, 40,000 came to it. What do you think the numbers were this year?
I don't want to, I'm not too sure on that. It's definitely more than that, because obviously, like, we added to the numbers, but I wouldn't know what to say how many, because I only went to a couple of hotels. I didn't go to every single one of them, so I can't say how many words, but it's definitely had to be, like, at least over 42.
Yeah, oh, that's a good roundabout number. I would say, like, 42, 43. It's because it's just so packed, and I'm sure they had to have a cap at one point. They couldn't let everybody in, and it's just grown. So now, because it used to be, I think last year it was 4 hotels, if I remember correctly, and then the 5th one was just added this year because of the sheer size of it. So, and then another thing is that since everything's within a mile radius of each other, be prepared. We had to do lots and lots of walking. The cool thing about it, though, is that all the hotels are not really that far away from each other, and the Hyatt, the Marriott, and the Hilton, they were all connected to a skybridge, via skybridge. So you can go, you don't have to go into the street. Like, for example, today, or yesterday, was it both today and yesterday it was raining, or?
Just today.
All right, just today, like, it was raining, so you didn't have to go outside. You can go through the skybridge along the three hotels there. So, did you do a lot of walking?
Not that really. I don't think I did that much walking. It actually wasn't that bad. But then again, I also did a lot more. I went to more panels than I usually do. So I actually had a lot more breaks in between the walking to sit.
Just sit down and relax there. It's just, we'll go to panels for a little bit. But it's also with the walking is that because it's so crowded, it's more of like a shuffle as opposed to a walking, because you're just, because the only times that you really got a break from the walking other than panels is when there was a panel going on. At least the areas were a little bit more clear. You didn't have to worry about too much about crowding, but it was still crowded enough as is.
Well, I think from what I saw, the only one that really had the room where you could just sit down and relax, even if you weren't at a panel, was the Hyatt. I think that had the most room. To like on the one floor, had more room for you to just sit along the wall and just relax.
Yeah, that's definitely a good one. I thought the Marriott had a lot of room, especially that one area.
That one area.
There was an area there in the Marriott. I think, yeah, it's like sort of next to the dealer's room, and then there's one upstairs right next to the atrium ballroom, where it was just filled with cosplayers and just people taking pictures and just everybody just having a genuine good time there. So, yeah, those were some of our expectations. Now we're going to go on to some of the issues that we ran into. And there, honestly, there were not a lot of issues. There weren't a lot with this convention at all. And the first one we're going to go into is the schedule booklet. I don't know if you've got one around here.
No, it's in my bag.
I think your bag's over here.
Oh,
yes. Yeah, so she's looking for it, the schedule booklet. Now, basically, there it is. When you came into registration, you have your schedule
a little falling apart.
You have your program guide here, and how it's thick. There was a lot going on there.
Well, the reason it's thick is it's not like a normal booklet that would be like program that would be like a normal 8x10 size. So they actually crammed a lot more into it, so it looks like it's a lot more. So, but they just condensed it more. But it's a little bit on the more confusing side because of the fact that it's so many pages since they condense it. Otherwise, I think it would be better. But the problem is they separate it versus track. Like they have the sci-fi is one track, anime is another track, British sci-fi. Stuff like that. And then each, instead of doing, besides just, you know, the usual grid, they then listed, okay, this is all what's going on under the sci-fi track. This is all going under the independent film track. So you could actually see specifically what track it was, and that's where it told you what room and how long it was and who was in it. And then it also gave you the map. But it's just it's a little hard seeing it this way. If it was a regular booklet size, I think it would have been much better.
Like the size of like the program book that you can get, like something like that. Although, well, obviously it's a program guide for a reason. I don't think
Something like this size would have been worked out better.
Okay, yeah, maybe a little bit thinner, and well, it's also this one had all the guests. There were a gazillion guests here.
Well,
so
I know other cons. What they'll do is this will be the program book, and then they'll have a lot thinner one that's the schedule.
Okay, yeah, that makes things just a little bit easier there. So, But DragonCon did come up with some new things, so that sort of helped them along with it. The big thing was that if you had a smartphone, whether it was an Android, a BlackBerry, or an iPhone, you were able to get the DragonCon app. And I thought that was really, really useful because it condensed basically everything that was in those two books into your phone. And I like the scheduling about it more is because it gave you an option to, like, you can look through all the events, or you can just look through each individual track. Usually I just went through all the events, and you can mark down which ones you wanted to go to, and then it would have a schedule on when you were supposed to go to them. And if there were anything that was conflicting, you would see it right away, a sort of a grid type of thing. So I thoroughly enjoyed that. Also gave you alerts. It gave you any news that was happening during the convention. They have their newsletter called The Daily Dragon that was going, I think, practically every day, and they had a new issue out every day. So,
I think also the app allowed for instant feedback.
Yeah.
So, because I remember one of the guests that we were talking to saying that with that, because of the app, they were expecting a lot better, more easily received feedback to understand what size rooms were good, which ones were bad, which ones they were too conflicting, stuff like that.
Yeah, so it's just it was definitely a good thing. And also, just one more thing about the app is that it wasn't that. It was just a good thing. And I think that with the instant feedback thing, I think they're going to get a lot of people that saying that the app was a good thing. Keep going with it. Maybe they'll make some improvements along. I would like to see them at least have one thing that I did have a gripe about, though, is that I couldn't see what was in the room during the time. So at least that would be a cool thing to have, like, what was going on in, like, Centennial Ballroom in the Hyatt all day Saturday. So at least I know which events were there, what time should I line up for it, is there an event happening at 7? So it was a pretty good thing. And then another thing with the scheduling is timing in between panels. Now, each panel ran for about an hour or so. But it gave you but there was a half an hour in between the end of the first end of one panel, the beginning of the next one.
Yeah. They scheduled it every hour and a half was a panel, but the panels either went from the lengths were usually either an hour or 2.5.
Yeah.
So that always gave you that extra half an hour at the end to try to get to another panel and also to clear out that room and fill in for the next panel.
Exactly, and actually the big event rooms. Like the Grand Ballroom at the Sheraton, the Centennial, the Regency, like all the big rooms, all those rooms were cleared out before every panel. They even had a big sign that said so. So it's just, it works the same way as, if I remember correctly, Hall H in San Diego Comic-Con, because they did that. They cleared out the room for every single one, so that way they get a fresh crowd in there, and if you wanted to stay for that, for a particular panel, you had to stay in line for it, so you had to rough it out just like everybody. So, all right, so that was our first issue there. The second one that we had was just finding the damn room itself. Whatever the panel it was, panels were great. They were awesome. We're not bashing that. It's just that we just got to find the room because there were so many that you really had, and the maps were helpful, but only to an extent. You had to really understand it. Did you get lost during any point?
Not really. When I was looking for a specific room, the map did help. But if it was just in general, like, okay, where are you? I'm over by this panel, over on this side of the building, over on this floor. It kind of, everything was everywhere. So it was kind of hard, like, I was sitting at one of the panels and one of the guys wanted to come join me for the panel. It was like, all right, I'm on the second floor, back behind the blood drive, all the way in the right corner. And it's like you had to make sure everyone knew where certain specific things were. If you didn't have a map, it did make it hard. But luckily, the one thing they did do right was a lot of the, even the hotel staff knew where certain panels were. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So even if you didn't know 100% where the paneling was, even if all you, and if they at least could guide you in the right direction, and if you were lucky enough to know the actual room number, the hotel staff was great about helping you with that. But I think it's because they had, it's all over the place since it's so many different buildings and they're using so many different floors on different buildings. It does get a little confusing, but I'm sure if after a couple of years of going, you know where everything is.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, after you just need to, I think a Thursday should just, I think what they should do on Thursday is that give a tour of the entire place. Like, no, seriously. I'm saying this. Like, have something scheduled because they have on Thursdays. On the Thursday before the convention, from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. is pre-registration. If they want, like, we'll say starting at 5 p.m., if they want to do, like, any, like, the newbie orientation to find out where the rooms are, you could spend an hour just trying to say, hey, this is where the Westin is, this is where this is. If you want to go to certain rooms downstairs to the left, like, you know, maybe, like, an hour or so, and they could do that for three times, like, 5, 7, 9.
One of the friends me and Chris had that we were talking to Friday night, he's now joined up working a lot with the con, and he said one of his ideas was on Thursday, do something similar to that, and also for any time where it's their first time at the con, put like a little like decal, well, he said put a cherry on it, put like a cherry sticker on your name on the badge so people knew you were a first timer, and if people saw it, they're more likely, they'll be like, oh, do you know where you're going, do you need any help with anything, because we've even seen it at cons, we're all friendly with each other at cons. You're always out to help people and be a family. So he agreed with the same thing, saying there should be some kind of orientation for the new timers.
Yeah, at least something to say, hey, you know what, this is where everything is, because
you know you're going to be confused.
Because it's over, like, when you first come here, it's just overwhelming, just the sheer size, as we were saying earlier, and the crowds and all the people there. So it does get overwhelming. It may be even a little intimidating to some people. So, yeah, just a tad bit. So I think, like, the maps were helpful to an extent. But you just really needed to just one day for like an hour or so lock down and just walk the entire convention and just see where everything is. Because we didn't even know, like, for example, our last day, we didn't even know there was an extra floor on, I think, the Hyatt or the Marriott?
The Marriott.
The Marriott. We didn't even know there was an extra floor at the bottom of it all because we thought there were two dealers' room and that was it. And then we find out, hey, there's another one.
There's a third one even lower.
Yeah, exactly. So we'll talk about that in a bit. So those are really our only issues with this convention is just the scheduling and where everything is. But you know what? We have a lot of pluses. We have a lot of things that we knew that the convention did right. And the first thing I put down was tight security.
Oh, yeah.
That had to be locked down because people are going to be drunk all over the street, especially because of the fact that it's a very adult-oriented convention. And you're going to have just drunk people everywhere, and you have to control it. It may be a little bit of a pain, but it's necessary. You got to have that there.
I think they also had the tight security was after a certain time, you could not get into the hotels unless you had a badge or a room key to that particular hotel. But earlier in the day, they were letting anybody just wander into certain areas of the hotels. You could go down and just see all the congoers, see the cosplayers. But after, I think it was like after like 6 p.m.
I think it was from 7 p.m. to 1 a.m. They wouldn't let anybody in the hotels unless you had the badge or the room key.
Right.
So
It was mostly to keep like anybody that might cause trouble out.
Yeah, I think that's
even just, though that'd be half the congoers.
Yeah, exactly. But you know what? It's necessary. They had to do it, especially 40,000 people, and they're taking over downtown Atlanta. Okay. Yes. So all right. So, but another plus was the flowing crowd traffic. They kept going along with tight security, they kept it moving.
Yes.
If you were standing around in a place, they told you had to move. They had to keep everything going, and they were on top of that. And once again, it was a pain, but it was necessary. It's definitely a good thing. You wouldn't want to cause any blockage that's happening during the...
Well, they did that a lot with the escalators. They had areas roped off in the escalators, and they had the hotel staff at the top and the bottom of the escalators, making sure you didn't just stand there in front of the escalator blocking and flowing traffic. And there were quite a few signs up in certain areas. Photography was prohibited, like the sky bridges. You could not take pictures on the sky bridges because it was barely enough flow, just barely enough room just to have the two lanes of traffic going one way and the other. So they didn't, it was too tight for you to be standing there taking a picture and blocking everything. So that was one of the areas that you could not take pictures.
Oh yeah, no, that's definitely a good thing right there, because or else if there was pictures being taken in there, that would
blocked
be a
both
yeah,
sides.
Yeah, and that would be it. There would be no, there'll be a lot of traffic there. Another thing is that come upon that a little bit earlier. The convention's very adult oriented. If you're under what age? We'll say 16,
yeah.
15.
I'd say 16. Yeah.
Around 16, yeah. This isn't a convention really where, how's the best way to put this? Like, I don't think this would be the convention for them, because
right.
I think it's a little bit more adult. It's a little bit more like, has a better, like, I'm trying to figure out like how to put this, like other than adult oriented, because it's just.
Some areas and some topics can be a little risque. Or a little, well, language can get foul. And then there's also with the whole allowing of alcohol being around the con.
That would probably be the big thing why they really couldn't let people do that, because it's like alcohol's, it's not really free, but you buy it and you can go around anywhere with it.
Right.
You can have a beer bottle, like, in the middle of the hotel. You can basically be drinking. And like you were saying earlier, they're at the Firefly sing-along. People were drinking. They had their beers up. They were, like, drinking. They were going along, having a
glasses of wine. Yep.
Exactly. So it's more for the adults. It's more for, like, 21 and over. It's not like the 16 and under can come. Like, the whole
can't come. It's not like they can come. It's just as there's certain things they can and can't do and can't go to.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they'll block some people out. Like, if they have what is known as DragonCon After Dark contest. And it's basically, it's a costume contest for anyone over 21. And yeah, those are a little bit risque, so they really don't. So with that one, they gotta ID people. So
Yeah. It's
not bad. It's like you can come, you're 21 and under people, but it's just
a little on the limited side.
Yeah, I think that's what it is. You're not really gonna get the full con experience. There's the better way to put
right.
it. You're not gonna get the full experience of it until you're over 21. But bring your kids; they have fun. So all right. All right, another plus is that there's a wide variety. Now, let's take a look at that program book. And you can just look at the schedule. I'm sorry, yeah. You look at the schedule, and the first page you see is just a whole bunch of tracks. And they're just lots of them. Like, it's, I think some of the ones that they had in there was like Whedonverse. It was all about Josh Whedon. Whedon, there we go.
Yeah. Stargate has its own, Star Wars has its own, Star Trek has its own, science, robotics, podcasting, MMOs, Filk, gaming, independent film and festival. There's two American sci-fis, there's animation, and then anime has its own.
Yeah.
It's just like they separate everything into like, looks like 15 or 16 tracks.
Yeah, there's a lot like going on, and it's not just science fiction and fantasy. They also do talk about electronics. They do talk about space, and like I know one panel that I saw was writing as well. Like one panel I was really wanted to see. I was because I was interested in it. Is that it was talking about NASA and what are they going to do now, because the space shuttle program is no more. They just had their last mission. I think a couple of weeks ago, a couple of months ago. And they're trying to figure out, okay, what now for NASA? What are you going to do about space exploration? And obviously the big thing is it's going to go commercial. So they were talking about that. They were wanted to discuss about that. Another one is, let's see, what are some of the tracks on there? They had British sci-fi. That I'm sure that's like a lot of like Doctor Who and Ashes to Ashes.
Yeah. Young adult literature. X-Track, I'm not sure what that is. I have a bad feeling.
They have Skeptics. That's sort of more of like a pop culture type of thing, because we saw a lot of things about like SNICK and Nickelodeon, like iCarly and Victorious, a show on Nickelodeon. They had their own panels. They had some dark fantasy and horror. So it's really, there was a lot, like, going on, and what's the X track about?
It looks like just random stuff.
Oh, I guess they couldn't really categorize
things,
period, so they put that on there.
Let's see. It looks like a lot of TV stuff.
Okay, so...
Didn't go on anything of those.
Let's see what other ones might interest some people. They have Tolkien's Middle Earth, so anything dealing with Lord of the Rings. Yep. They had a whole track dedicated to it. They had a whole one dedicated to the paranormals.
Asian cinema and culture.
Yeah.
Reading.
They had robotics. Yeah. There you go. Dark
fantasy. Kaleidoscope, I think it was children's stuff.
It was a lot going on, and it sort of proves right there that it wasn't so much sci-fi and fantasy, it was more pop culture.
DragonCon is more than just like Otakon, it's more like Icon bigger. It's just a convention for nerds. If it's nerd, it's good.
There you go. That'd be the best way to put it. Alright, another thing is that we were talking about earlier was another plus is the dealer's room. Because we found, how many were there? Three? Yeah. So we had, there were two ups, there were two.
On the same floor, there was two on opposite sides of the floor. And then there was one below it that took up about half the floor. The good thing about that is, now you have it split up. Instead of having all the entire, like, convention in one big room, you have them split up among multiple floors, multiple rooms, and they're not crowding up one space.
Yeah, I think that's definitely, like, a good thing there. And also, the Artist Alley, they split that up. They split it up, I think, with one was, like, comic books and pop art, they called it, and then the other one was the actual art show itself. So it's sort of definitely breaking everything up into smaller areas definitely made it more concentrate and more focused. So that way, at least, you know, if you wanted to see something, you didn't have to walk the entire dealer's room to look for it. You knew exactly which room to go to. And where that booth, that particular booth is looking for. Yeah.
But the good thing was, sometimes you worry that when they do stuff like that, when they broke it up, they didn't go, okay, there's one dealer's room in the Hyatt, there's one dealer's room in the Marriott, there's one in, no, they put all the dealer's room in the Marriott, they had all the artists in the Hyatt. So it wasn't like you had to go all over the place to find them. They were in the same buildings near each other, they just weren't with each other.
Yeah, so that was definitely a good thing there. And then finally is that the big plus is that Atlanta, south of what, Virginia or so, south of Maryland, they're known for their southern hospitality. And we definitely experienced that this weekend here in Atlanta. As we were touching upon earlier, the staff was friendly.
Yep.
Most of the congoers, they were friendly, had some etiquette. Not all of them, but, you know, it's just...
Nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect.
Yeah, exactly. So I think that was definitely the big thing here because people were friendly.
Even on the bus, when we were going, we took the bus and the train from the hotel to the con since we weren't...
It took an hour to get there.
Because we weren't right in the middle of the city and it was cheaper than taking the car every day. But even on the buses, on the trains, on our hotel, everyone was just friendly. Even on the people on the streets, in the restaurants, everyone was friendly.
Yeah, you know what the funny thing is that when we would walk from our hotel to where the buses had to be, where we had to go for the buses, we had to walk through a mall, and everybody wasn't really so much... When people, like, looked at us cosplaying, like, mostly, like, you, Tom, and Chris, they weren't, like, there, like, whispering, and, like, it looked like they were saying bad stuff. They were like, oh, look at that. It's just, their kids
want... Oh, there's Jack Sparrow.
Yeah. Yeah, a couple wanted pictures, so it's just... It was definitely a real friendly atmosphere, and also with the con staff and the hotel staff even, they had the tremendous job, they had the hard job of just controlling the crowd and making sure, telling them where everything was. It's not like where if someone asked you, if you asked them a question, it's not like you didn't feel that they were annoyed about it.
Right. Especially having done this for so many years, some of these people.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, I think also the hotel staff and the con staff know is that this convention brings this city a good amount of money. And it was sort of like, you know what? You all come back now.
Yep.
That was the feeling that they wanted to have. And we'll see at the end of it all if we'll be back.
Yeah. Well, also, it's also the entire city knows about DragonCon. How many of us, when Tom, Chris, and I were on the bus yesterday, on Saturday, and no, not Saturday, Sunday. I'm getting confused with the number of days. On Sunday, when we came back from the con, how many people were on our way? Oh, you're going to DragonCon? Yeah, 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 we're going to DragonCon. And or, oh, I didn't get to go this year because I couldn't get time off. Or, oh, I only got to go to one day. What was going on? Yeah. Everyone knows the con, and almost, I think, most of the city of Atlanta has been to DragonCon at one point.
Oh, yeah, definitely. I think it's just that, like, where our hotel is, it's actually from DragonCon itself. It's about a good 20 to 25 minute drive. And we're actually in a suburb called Cobb. And people here knew about the convention. So if you had people that were staying at a hotel 20, 25 minutes away that knew about the convention, you know you got something good going on there. So definitely the hospitality has been great. Hopefully we'll be back next year. Now, with our hotel being so far away, if we come back, we got to get closer. We got to get a hotel that was definitely closer. And this year they had 5 official hotels that held the actual convention itself. I think they had overflows, but I'm not sure where those hotels were. And the hotels that they had were the Westin, the Marriott, the Hilton, the Hyatt, and the Sheraton. Now the great thing about these hotels is that we were talking about earlier.
Walk away from each other.
Oh yeah, they're not that far. Yeah.
The Hyatt and the Marriott were the closest. They were right across the street from one another, and I think the Hilton was like the next building over. Yep. And the Westin was like less than a block down that way, and I think the Sheraton was like less than a block. It was like a block down the other way.
Yeah, it was 2 blocks. The Westin was about a block and a half away from the Hyatt, and the Sheraton was about 2 blocks away from the Hilton. And when they put it, I remember watching DragonCon TV, like the little things, like, you know how Anime Boston has their pre-show slideshows. I know you haven't been to there. Yeah, for those who have been there, they have their pre-show slideshows. DragonCon TV is the same concept behind it. So
that looks a lot like Adult Swim on Cartoon Network.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, that was a lot like it. Plus also with DragonCon TV, it's a little bit. That was an actual like official channel in the hotels. They broadcasted panels. Like if you could not make it to any panels or any of like the major ones, they broadcasted the show live in your hotel room. So if you like, for example, if you could not make the masquerade or any of the concerts or anything like that, the Carrie Fisher panel that they had, you can flip. Yeah, that one got moved to the big room, and you can turn to your TV to whatever channel it was at your hotel, and you can watch the panel in your room. That was a huge convenience. I think that's a big plus for me right there.
Yeah.
So that way, at least,
everyone in one of those hotels.
Exactly. So that's why we're going there. That's why we're doing it next year. But anyways, moving with the hotels, they're not that far away from each other. The hardest trek that you have to have is from the Sheraton to the Westin, and the reason being is that you have to go uphill.
Yes.
There's a part of downtown where it's hilly. It's not too bad, but it's pretty hilly, pretty steep. So it's just, I think that was what, 0.3 of a mile. That I think that's what it was that they had. Oh, it's still too much. it's not. And they say, you know, nerds, they say you don't get exercise during DragonCon. I'm sure we all did
they
a lot of work.
Nerds don't exercise.
Exactly. So, but the great thing about these hotels is that they had different uses for them. They had their specialty. Like if I was thinking of the Hyatt, I would think of mostly like a lot of the music, a lot of the main events that they had, the big main events that they had.
I think the Hyatt had a lot of was besides the music and the main events, it was also I think mostly like the medieval and fantasy stuff, while like the Marriott had a lot of the sci-fi tracks.
Yeah, they had a good amount of them there. I know the Sheraton had a good amount of the Star Trek tracks there. They had those. The Westin had a lot of the zombies. They had a lot of like
steampunk.
I think it was they called that not the steampunk. The zombie track was called why is that word
escaping?
Yeah, it is. It began with an A, like A
Apocalypse Rising?
Yeah, that was it. That's why it's, like, escaping me, but...
Well, no, because I also know that was the panel where we went to the Firefly stuff, and Firefly is considered steampunk.
Oh, okay, so...
So that's where the... Because I know Tom went to a couple of those, and those were all in the Westin were the steampunk ones.
All right, and then the Hilton, I think, was a lot of the pop culture stuff, like the Skeptics, like the Space, like the Tronics, the... a lot of, like, podcasting. So a lot of that was there. So each hotel had their own use, and they had their own special track. So if you were interested in one thing, you were going to spend a lot of time in that hotel.
Which is good. You don't have to constantly go back and forth between hotels.
Exactly. Now, now out of the hotels there, which one was your favorite and why?
That's confusing. Well, the only ones I went to like one panel in the West, and the rest, I mainly stayed in the Hyatt and the Marriott. So, I guess panel-wise and, like, just navigating-wise, I like the Hyatt. But the Marriott, it just visually was appealing. And I just, there was certain things that were my favorites that were in the Marriott. Like, they had the artists, the musicians had their booths lining around the elevators. Because that's where I spent most of my time, hanging out with Elmer Bros.
Yes. So it's, I would go with, like, I like the Marriott a lot. I really like the...
47 flights.
Yeah, the 47, the 47 floors that they have there. Like,
wow.
Yeah, you just looked, like, in day three when we did it there, you just look up and it's just like, wow, how the hell, like, how is it so high? And all the hotels there, at least that, at least 30 to 40.
I think the was a little shorter.
Yeah, just a tad bit, but it was definitely like you still had all those rooms up. So no matter what, if you were gonna stay in one of those hotels, you were gonna have a fun elevator ride up. So
yeah,
and
that's why we're gonna try and book one of those hotels next time we do, so we can piss Chris off.
Yeah, he told us, Pirate Chris told us that he had to help out a friend on the 30th floor from the Marriott, and they have glass elevators throughout each of them. And once you get in there, it's just a straight, it's like basically, it's like they just attached a rocket to it and boom, you're up there. And it's like kind of like when you're if you're not used to it, you're holding on for dear life at one point.
I would love to have been there with Chris.
I think at one point I made the trek to go up to the 16th floor. And while I was going up, I held on just a tad. I'm like, wow, I can't. This is a little bit.
I think they also said, though, is Congos could go up to a certain height. But if you wanted to go past a certain floor, you had to have a hotel key card in order to go over a certain floor.
Yeah, so you can go up to, like...
You can just wander the hotel.
You can wander up to floor 41, but that's... After that, you have to have the key from...
I think it was after floor, like, 20, you had to have a key card. But they didn't want you wandering the entire hotel.
That's understandable, definitely. But definitely next time we're going to try to get a hotel and hopefully one that has, like, a skyrocketing room. So next year, if you hear from us, you know we want a high room. I will request that just to piss him off. All right, so next thing is that with the convention being in downtown Atlanta, there's a lot that you can see and do. We'll say, for example, you can only get a two-day pass, and it was for Friday and Saturday. Sunday, Monday, what are you going to do? Well, that's what Atlanta's here for. There's a lot of spots that you can go to. So one example that we did was the World of Coca-Cola. Oh, yeah, that reminds me. I got to get the song for Chris later that they play when you enter the museum. He hates it. What else was like? What I know we didn't see much yet, but what are you expecting to see from Atlanta?
I'm mostly looking forward to the aquarium tomorrow. That was like a big thing. That was like one of the things we planned. We're gonna be there longer than the convention. What are we gonna do? We're going to the aquarium because aquariums are always fun. Yeah. Even if you're not a big fish person, they're still fun. Especially if you go with a group of friends that you know that you're going to have a blast with. That was pretty much the only thing I was looking forward to. I just wanted to see see how Atlanta compares to other big cities. Now that we've been to, like, Boston and New York City and Baltimore, just see how, and you've been to San Diego and LA, just to see the comparisons between the big cities. Like, today, after the con closed, Chris even said, he's like, wait, where are all the cabs? Where are all the people? It was a ghost town once
the con was
closed.
Yeah, once the con was done, it was nothing. And it was just like, wow, this is something completely new that you just look around and be like, this is the oddest thing I've ever seen. You yeah. still because it's just like you expect to see like the city be vibrant. But it's not really that vibrant. It's probably because
it's Labor Day.
Yeah, it's Labor Day.
People were probably away. That weren't if you weren't at the con, you were probably away for the weekend.
Oh yeah, definitely. I think tomorrow morning it'll pick up. You'll see businesses going and you'll see people coming and going out of the hotels. But there's a lot of things to do here in Atlanta. You can go to Six Flags over over Georgia or over America here.
Over Georgia.
Six Flags. Okay, so
I
six.
I
so they have a Six Flags here. Another thing is that they have a Stone Mountain Park. And that you need a taxi for. But I hear that every night there, they do a laser light show set to music over the mountains. So I heard that was a really good show. I wish we could go see that, but we're only staying the day. Something that interests me personally, two things. The CNN Center that they have there. You can take a tour of the place. And also Turner Field, where the Braves play. I went to that on Thursday. I had fun. I
had fun in the pool here.
I know. I kind of wanted to go in the pool, but now it's like, eh. It doesn't matter. I had fun. So yeah, there's a lot to do in this city other than once the convention is done, you don't have to come here Thursday night, pick up your pass, and then, yeah, and leave Monday morning. Stay here the extra couple of days. Enjoy the city. Enjoy the Southern hospitality. It's Atlanta at its finest, so... And see the buildings there. So,
getting comfy.
Yeah, we have to. All right, so, let's see. Another thing is the MARTA. We don't need to go into that. Yeah, because the train system, it's not...
The train system isn't... It's a train system, it's a subway system, it's a bus system.
Yeah, that's pretty
Luckily,
much...
Luckily, they don't change much. They don't vary that much.
No, they don't. They had a couple stops, but it was definitely easy to use.
Yes, yeah. It was.
So... Thank you, Marta, for that. All right, next thing up, let's go to panels. Let's go back to the convention.
Right.
Chrissy, what panels did you go to?
I went to the Emerald Rose Performance Friday, where they also had a Lord of the Rings costume contest. That one, me and Chris said we had to go to because we have not seen Emerald Rose since their last appearance at Icon, which was quite a few years ago. Chris,
06?
I think it was 06. 03, then they were there in 03, and then they were there in 05. So, no, 05 would have been the last time being there. Chris is really good friends with the band because he's the dancing pirate of Icon. So, they're the ones that made Chris who he is.
Okay. So Chris would not be who he is today without Emma Rose.
Nope, he would not. So, Chris and I have corresponded with them quite a bit on Facebook and... all that over the years, and it was really good to see the guys again. We haven't seen them in a long time, and they've had new CDs out since the last time we saw them, so we had to catch up on that.
Okay.
And they were really glad to see us. Apparently, all of their wives know about Chris.
Yeah, that's what I find kind of odd. He is like, it's not like so much a bad thing for Chris. It's just like their wives know about them, and
they've talked about Chris a lot with other people, so that's how they've heard about Chris. And you know, Chris is one of, as much as we bash Chris and we joke about Chris,
yeah, we still do.
He's one of our great friends, but he's got that personality. He's one
no,
of those,
he doesn't.
He's a people person, so that's just his personality.
Yeah. Right, Chris?
I almost thought he was asleep. I also went to an autograph signing. Chris and I both went. Timothy Zahn. He's a Star Wars writer, and he's also a Terminator writer, which he was very happy to see Chris show up with two Terminator books because everyone else online had Star Wars books. And then I went to Timothy Zahn's Q&A panel on a book, his first Star Wars book, which is the book that pretty much re-jumped, was a reboot for the Star Wars franchise, but in written form.
Okay.
The 20th anniversary book comes out actually tomorrow. The book comes out, which he actually said he told Del Rey, have it out this weekend. They said no. You know how, because we were all saying how much money they would have made if they'd sold the book this week.
Yeah, if they sold it this weekend, then I think they would have made a killing for it.
Actually, there were a couple of vendors in the dealer's room that broke the street date. They were selling them on Friday. They didn't sell a lot of them, but there were a couple of people in line for the autograph signing that actually had the book. But it was cash only. It was like they would sell it, but cash only.
Yeah.
Other than that, it was that panel was a Q&A basically on the book and how the original storyline versus new additions to the special, anniversary one, which after seeing the panel, I definitely want the anniversary book. Yes. It's got special stuff in it. Then Tom and I went to ask the authors on Sunday, which was basically a panel of Star Wars writers. You can see a theme I'm going with here.
You can't tell by the shirt, so I just...
I'm the Star Wars...
Yeah, I wonder it's the Star Wars fan.
I went to the Star Wars... it was... Basically, they had 7 Star Wars authors, and they asked questions about writing for the genre and all that kind of stuff. And then after that, we went to another Emerald Rose performance, which was in a too small of a room.
Didn't you go to, like, every Emerald Rose performance that they had?
We missed the 12:30 one on Friday. We missed the 7:30 one on Thursday. But we went to the 8:30 on Friday. The 7 on Friday, the 8 on Sunday. And then we went to the 2 o'clock one today. But the 2 o'clock one was more like just a performance for the con. They were in the hallway. They weren't in a room.
Yeah, I think they were for Emerald Rose, I think they were the last performance on that stage for the year. So they closed it out with them. They were the headliners, so.
Yeah, and they didn't have to clean up a room. It was just a hallway. But yeah, basically the theme was Star Wars and Emerald Rose. But you know what? Star Wars was my first nerd passion.
Yeah.
It's gonna stay my nerd passion. And it was, like I said to you in the dealer's room, I'm always going to anime conventions. So I tried to steer away from those things because I'm always going to that stuff. Mm-hmm. This is my first chance. Well, unfortunately, we couldn't get press this year. So it was my chance to be a congo and go to the things that I want to go to. And I haven't been to Star Wars stuff in so long. And it felt so great going to that. Especially talking with the people online and when we got into the rooms, just talking about Star Wars and the characters and the books. It was great.
You could tell that she really enjoyed them. Let's see. My panels I went to were mostly TV. TV and film, they're surprising, isn't it? It's funny, no, because you were talking about Star Wars and how that was like your first passion. TV and filmmaking and broadcasting were my first passions.
We didn't realize that.
Yeah, of course not. Yeah, yeah. No, they're my first passions, and it was great to see something where I went to a convention and I was able to see that. I was able to see, you know, they had a 3-part panel throughout the entire of a 3 different parts, 3 different days, where they would go through how to make a movie A through Z. And the first part they would talk about would be post-production, and then the next day would be production, pre-production, then would be production, then it would be post-production. So we went through all the different stages of actually how to make a movie.
Didn't they have other steps where it was like, oh, prop and costume making and all that?
Exactly, yeah. They had, like, they would show you how to make certain props. They would show, like, makeup and special effects. That's a big thing you really don't see at conventions. They also had one, I thought this was really good, something for the independent filmmaker. It's a big thing with them. Like, I'll dabble on with it. Like, the big thing is the camera known as the DSLR. Not the camera, but it's digital single lens reflective camera. And a lot of filmmakers are using it because it's not too expensive, but it's something where it's easily affordable as opposed to an actual like film camera itself. So that was one of the big things that I wanted to go to. We're not that far away. another thing that like I had a lot of fun at was the zombie walk. I thought that was fun.
I saw your pictures from that.
Yeah, that was a good time because it's just like at one point the guy just looked at I had my camera out. There were several photographers there, like professional ones. And the guy pointed me out and he's like, "You, photographer, where dictate this." So I was able to direct a part of the zombie walk. I'd be like, "Guys, just come crawling out to me, eat brains, do something, make some noises." So it was a really fun time. And then
you kind of got to be director.
Yeah, pretty much with that one. And it was just like, it was fun. Just at one point, I'm sure I'll show the footage on this, where I have my camera with me and they start the walk. And in order to get to where they need to go, they had to pass right through me. Ooh, so I'm in the middle. I'm in the middle of it. I'm like, oh dear God, this is not gonna be good. And it was it was a fun time though, because they went through the Westin, then they went outside. It's funny, like, because they had to go outside. So they, when they were explaining the rules for the zombie walk, they said the one thing was zombies obey traffic laws. That was one of the things. So they had to basically, when it stopped, obviously when the light's red, you had to stop. You had to do all sorts of things. But they had a lot of fun with it. I think they went to the Westin, then they went through the Marriott, and they ended up at the Hilton. So that they went through that course, and that was the end of it there. Another big thing was obviously what DragonCon's most famous for is the parade. That was a big thing there. We woke up too late and we couldn't make it.
Boy, did we oversleep.
Yeah, DragonCon was good, but mostly we slept during the convention.
I don't think we've ever slept this much at a con before. And actually, we were talking about something towards the end, and I said something about, wow, we got a lot of sleep, and somebody looked at me and goes, if you got too much sleep, you did something wrong.
We did something wrong. So,
but you know what? Unlike other cons where we're rushing, oh, we got to go cover this, we got to cover that, we got to film this, we got to interview these people. Yeah. With us not being pressed, we got to relax. And since it's our first time, and we actually, looking through the schedules, didn't see a lot that we really wanted to go to, it was a chance for us to relax and enjoy it. So to a degree, that's a good thing that we got a lot of sleep, because we got to enjoy it and relax. But to a degree, we spent a lot of time in the hotel room.
Yeah. It was a good thing to get a lot of sleep, but we got a lot of sleep. So, but yeah, I went to that. I went to the Miss Star Trek Universe pageant. That was interesting. And then finally the masquerade. And I said during, I think it was day three update, where I said the best part of the masquerade was the host, because they were just saying every offensive thing under the sun. And,
well, that goes towards the adult theme.
Yeah, exactly. So that was a lot of fun, and I'll post up the entire masquerade soon. So those were some of the panels that we attended there. Now, next thing I'm on our list, we're almost done, is cosplayers. The big thing right there. Dragon Con, they do have a lot of cosplayers, but definitely not like, it's not overpacked with them.
No,
you know how with some conventions, like mostly like Otakon, like Boston,
65-70% cosplayers.
Yeah, with DragonCon, there were a lot of cosplayers, but it wasn't
40%.
Yeah, I would go with that. Yeah, that's a good like roundabout number. It wasn't
not 50%, but not like, you know, barely anything. It was a little less than half.
Yeah, and the funny thing is that with these cosplayers, there was a wide variety. So we really couldn't talk about trends, because most of the only big trend you could really talk about is steampunk. That was the one thing that you could definitely notice.
I saw more comic book, if anything, more comic book characters as cosplayers, if you wanted to pick something that was particularly a large group of.
Like a genre-wise.
Yeah, genre-wise. There was mostly, from what I saw, it was definitely comic. You had your Supermans, your Batmans, Wonder Woman, Green Lantern, X-Men. You had all the comic, a lot of the comic book characters. But I also saw a lot of random ones. Like, my camera, I was in heaven. I'm like, oh my God, I gotta take a picture of that. That one's awesome. I never saw that one before at a con. It was just great that way.
Yeah, and it's also just go back with the masquerade, is that they had a contest during the show sponsored by the drink Fuse. And what it is that Fuse, and the contest was, you take two different characters and mix them together, or you do a different take on an original character, on an old character. So,
which we saw quite a bit of too.
Yeah, you see a lot of those. Like, for example, I know that you saw a steampunk R2-D2. We saw a pimped Vader.
There was the Renaissance Victorian style Justice League.
Yeah, that's something you really don't ever see. And it's just, you really just take you kind of scratch your head about it. It's like, oh, that's a different take on.
But you also go, that's awesome. I have to get that picture.
Exactly.
Like, I saw you go, oh my God. And I'm like, what's wrong? And I'm like, I see the group, and I'm like, okay, they're Victorian. And then you realize, like, a part of the one outfit, I'm like, oh my God, I think that's Wonder Woman. And like, oh my God, that's Batman. And then when you took a look at the picture afterwards, you're like, that's Nightwing, that's this one, that's that one. You're like, oh my god, that is amazing and brilliantly thought up.
Yeah, exactly. And that's something like you really don't see anywhere else, but that's the whole staple with DragonCon. Free expression. So, speaking of cosplayers, which one was your favorite?
Favorite as in, I'm going to do two types of favorites. One favorite is random favorite. Like, it's something you never saw. I don't remember the character's name, but he's from the movie Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
Oh, okay. Is that the one?
He was dressed all in black with the net. He was from when they go to the world where children were illegal. He was the hunter that would capture the children. And as soon as I saw him, I'm like, that is so random. It is so amazing and so old. Yeah. I loved it. I can't say I had a particular one that was like, that is the best cosplay I've ever seen. But
what's the best cosplay here?
Here, Jack Sparrow. No.
Of course, we had to break Krista, thank you.
I guess it was, there's a couple of Disney princesses. I couldn't pick a particular one, but there was actually quite a few of them that were, the costumes were done so well, and they were so detailed, some of them. Yeah. Like, I think there was one group of Disney princesses where they were not just their regular costumes, but they were done with, like, the golden style, where they had a lot of jewelry ornaments and all that on their dresses.
Okay.
But there was another one where the costume was not, it didn't look like you just grabbed some fabric out of the store and just went, you got the nice fabric to do it.
Yeah.
And they did a great job with those.
Okay. So, I'll go along with, let's see. I got two favorites. One was the Victorian Justice League. Because it was really something really inventive and something really original that
you couldn't figure out who two of them were.
Exactly. That's how good it was. Actually, you know what? We're seeing the picture up and just as we're almost running out of tape. And it's like, if anyone knows like all of them, please let us know. Because we're trying
to name like all but two of them.
Yeah. So we got to figure it out. So anybody knows, let us know. And that one. And, of course, I had to have Macho Man Randy Savage.
Yes, I knew you were going to say
that. That was definitely, because I think it's just more or less because the guy who portrayed him. Because he had Macho Man down to, like, a science.
Energy. He had the energy.
Yeah, exactly. So he had it down to a science. So those are definitely our favorites there. Now, next up, ratings. This is going to be a tough one. On a scale from 1 to 10, how would you rate DragonCon 2011 and why?
It would be a 9.5. Because it can't be 100. It can't be perfect. Nothing can ever be perfect unless, you know, they catered this con specifically to you. Like, everything revolved around you. That's the only way it could be a 10. So 9.5, it was so much fun. It was definitely a big change of pace for us. It was huge. We got to see old friends. You got to meet a lot of interesting people, see a lot of interesting costumes. And I have to say, for one thing with the cosplayers, I did not see one bad cosplay. I did not see any half-assed jobs. Everyone put effort and thought into their costumes.
Alrighty. So 9.5 from Krissy. Krissy also gives it a
9.5.
Tom, how about you?
He's probably asleep.
No, he was... He was up. He was in the bathroom, so...
Ah.
Yeah. I don't think we could hear him, but...
Whatever.
All right,
Tom's answer is you go to hell.
Okay, Tom... Okay, Tom told us to go to hell.
So I'm giving him a 9.5.
Okay, so Tom gets a 9.5. I'll give it, I was gonna give it a 9. What did you do, Chris?
Raisinets are fucking frozen.
We have
a really good...
9.2. You had to mess it up, didn't you?
9.5 would have been if I had some ice cold water being sold.
Oh, okay. No, there was actually a guy who was selling ice cold water for a dollar, but he didn't do the song. That was the thing.
No song doesn't count.
So Tom's a
9.2. I'll give it a 9.5 as well. Originally, I was going to give it a 9, but I think it's just the more and more I think about it, I had a blast. But yeah, I had a blast with it. It was a 9.5 all the way. So our final one, I think this is the best rating we've ever given it. Is
9.425.
Yeah, that's Tom fucking that up.
Yeah, it could have been.
What would have happened if it was a 9.5?
It would have been 9.5. Yeah, that's it. That's it. So yeah, yeah. I still got it.
We're all exhausted.
We're all a little bit tired now.
I need a pickaxe to eat these. Yeah.
So, actually, you know what? Later on, you can see on our Facebook. I'll put up a note of all the quotes from the weekend.
Oh, God.
That's what we're gonna start. That all quotes that we have said stupidly over the weekend. So
God, we had a lot.
I won't put up the insanely fucked up ones, but I will put some.
Give him at least one. Give him a preview.
A preview. What was one?
My favorite one. No,
we can't say that one. We can't say that one. We can't.
I think one was I said where it was like I reversed like three words.
Yeah, that no, but that always happens. It's I'm trying to remember. Yeah, we're not saying those.
No, I said a lie.
I know. We had to go through the whole list in order to see it. But what's some of the. There's no phone on your camera. That's when we're at Applebee's. I think at one point, I think Chris, like, he likes apple juice. And when he ordered it at the restaurant, he says, I want apple juice with no water. Let's see, yours. Yeah. I think the one that you reversed was, your gutter is in your mind already. Already your gutter is in your mind.
That was another first thing. I actually had alcohol. I never have alcohol.
Yeah, she never drinks. So she had. So this was. But anyways. Tom had a good time drinking at the convention. Those are our ratings right there. What were yours for DragonCon 2011? Make sure you leave a comment down below on it. Just choose it 1 through 10 and why. So before we go into our final thoughts. Some announcements. Our next convention for the Fans POV will be at New York Comic Con. We are coming, yes, Comic Con and Anime Fest. I have to add that along with it as well.
They combined it again.
Yep. Mm-hmm. It is, we are going from the Empire State of the South to the Empire State up North. Where the cabs hit you at a red light. Thank you, Chris. We won't be getting hit by cabs throughout the convention, but we will be doing updates from the convention floor October 13th through the 16th. Make sure you watch out for that. If you want to see the photos that we have taken throughout the entire weekend, make sure you go onto our Facebook. Actually, not so much Facebook because we'll put a small sampling up there, but we're going to have the majority of the pictures put up now on Flickr. Chris, are you excited about that?
Fuck is Flickr?
Yeah, you know what it is. Anyways, thank you for impersonating your mom, Chris. Right?
What the hell?
Yeah. So you'll be able to see. Yeah. Yeah. You're already a dead man, dude. All right. So if you want to see the photos that we've taken, you can check out either Facebook or Flickr. We recommend Flickr. So and other than that, some final thoughts from the weekend, Chrissy. Let's have some. No, it's not the final countdown yet, dude. Anyways, some final thoughts from the weekend, sorry.
Definitely a great time. I would have liked to have done a little bit more, but you know what? I enjoyed what I did do. I did enjoy walking around, all the pictures, all the panels I did go to. The dealers' rooms were nice, and seeing Emerald Rose again was great, and spending the weekend with you three nut jobs.
You know what the funny thing is that she, like, I'll give you a pound for that because you definitely spent a good amount of time with us. And the big thing as well is that we had the road trip, okay? So we had the big road trip on the way here, and we'll have a montage of that soon. So, yeah, this is definitely what we've been doing all weekend long. So it's one thing there. But a couple of my final thoughts is that, you know, I had a blast here. I had a lot of fun. It's good to be... I've been doing press for such a long time for conventions. You really do forget the fact of...
relaxing, enjoying yourself.
Yeah, relaxing and enjoying a convention. And that was definitely one of the first that I think I've done I think the last time I felt like this was like maybe when I first started doing like the documentaries and all that stuff.
Icon Virgin.
That was actually the first Fans POV technically.
Technically it was. So it was definitely some good times there. Chris, any final thoughts since you're in this panel now?
I'm in this panel now? Where? This is a panel?
Yeah. Johnny Depp.
Where?
Yeah.
I love this con so much.
He's been saying that all year.
And yeah, he's been saying
all he was, year.
He was so excited
here for a
weekend.
Every con, you've been saying I love this con.
Okay, yeah, this time though. I'm willing to give up Otakon for this con. I'm willing to give up a lot of cons just to come here because this is really worth it.
You know what? They started pre-reg now.
Yeah.
60, 65. It's if you want pre-reg, Tom, any final thoughts?
Yeah, actually, as much as we love the other cons that we've been to, we're actually thinking of foregoing Otakon next year, many of us, just to come back to this.
Well, that's why I have to laugh, because Chris never does anything at cons. Chris did stuff at the con this year.
I did. First of all, my mouth is full of foot by foot. Hold on. Okay. I did a lot of shit. I got two autographs.
I know, yeah. That's two more than your record, your previous record.
I got... No, because I've done Vic Mignogna.
Oh, okay. I know you've done...
Dirt.
Oh,
okay.
No, but I did Timothy Zane, and I did A.C. Crispin, who wrote some Star Wars books, but she also wrote the new Pirates of the Caribbean, The Price of Freedom, which was kind of funny because I was in costume when I went to go get the...
And she didn't sign the Jar of Dirt.
I didn't ask her to, but she did say... Like, she went to, like, tell the people online something. I forget what.
Yeah.
But noticed me and went, the star of the book is here.
So, all right. No, but, you know, Chris did a lot.
He never does anything in cons but wander around. He went to panels. He went to autograph signings. He went to concerts.
I haggled in the dealer's room. That never happens. I got a book from $20 down to $5.
There you go. That's some good things there. So
he went to the con one day and not in concert.
Yeah, he went to... That's a rarity.
Usually it's like a semi-watered down costume to be, like, still in costume but not fully... No,
a Terminator.
Or still a costume, though. Yeah. Just full on. Yo, Emerald Rose didn't even know it was me. Only Clyde. And I started talking to Brian, and he heard me, so he knew it was me. He turned around, oh, jeez!
So
it's a good con if Chris went out of character for the con.
Yeah, this is a great con.
This is a good convention. Now, the big thing with the four of us is now... Oh, okay, one more.
It's also worth to stay till the final end. Like, it ends at, like, 4?
It ends like a closing ceremony starts at 4. If you want to really get technical with it, it ends at 5.
Okay.
But
yeah.
But you know what? In all reality, it does end at 4 because the closing ceremony
it's
starts.
It's actually worth staying until those final moments. Like we don't even do that for Otakon. This con, it is worth it until the end.
We did. Me and Chrissy stayed for entire. We did that with KatsuCon. We stayed till the very end.
Yeah, but we were eating.
Yeah, and other things.
The thing was, Chris ended up for the final moments. Chris was helping Emerald Rose break down their booth.
That was awesome, by the way. That was fun.
Yeah, and Tom was getting autographs there. So, one final question I have to ask. Will you come back next year? And I'll start off with you, Chrissy.
I'm going to try and get the time off. I think I want to come back next year.
Alrighty, how about you, Chris? Will you come back next year?
After everything I've said... No.
You know what the funny thing is that we're...
Don't take him seriously.
No, see, we had a serious... Like, we had a serious moment. A really serious moment about that. And it was just like, yeah, we had to laugh about it. So we know that Chris wants to come back.
Hells yeah!
Tom, would you want to come back?
I'm going to put Chris on a plane.
Oh, yeah. See,
kill you.
Yeah, so.
No, you know what? You know what? This is DragonCon. I think I might willingly go on the plane to get here.
Oh my God! It's just breaking. The fourth.
This con has gotten me to be willing to go on a plane. I hate flying.
If there's one thing I know about you is that you do not like to fly. Just a short story about that. Back in high school, yes, we've known.
Just show them the footage.
No, ever
we
since. Yeah, I know we have it, just but it's better to just say it. It's like we've known each other since high school, and our senior trip was to Walt Disney World.
It was awesome.
Yes, he loved it, and we had a great time. But anyways, yeah, but the thing is that I was sitting right next to him on the plane on the way down, and even we didn't even take off yet, and he was scared out of his mind. He's like, "Oh my God! Oh my God! Oh my God!" And like,
and
I completely
Tom, fucking Tom goes, yeah, not you, Tom. This other kid, Tom goes, "Curse, we're gonna die!" And I'm like, "Shut up!"
I'm gonna get my camera and take my last pictures of my life.
Yeah,
that's
what I said.
No, I actually said I'm taking a camera out to take my last pictures of me.
So yeah, we got the footage in there. So that's a good time there. So in terms of me like actually coming back to this convention, I'm on board with you, Krissy. I will try to come back. We have a lot of things planned for. No,
let's apply for press first.
Yeah, Tom are promising to come back.
And Tom are willing to come back. Me and Krissy, we got to see if we got the time for it and we got the money for it. And it's also we're doing Disney right before. It's a week before the trip.
Wait, I figured it out. I figured out how to fund our trip next year.
How?
Bake sale.
A bake sale. Oh, a bake sale. So,
to way too much Lewis Black.
We can make an awesome cake, and then we'll sell it.
That was our road trip, was a lot of Lewis Black on the way down. So,
and you know what? My final thought on this entire con.
Okay.
If it wasn't for my horse, I wouldn't have spent that year in college.
So, alrighty then.
Sure, we'll see Lewis Black live.
We will see Lewis Black live. Anyways.
And if you tweet, fuck you!
We were a family show.
No, that was already out the door.
He's gonna put up a whole thing of the things that we've said this weekend. The messed up shit I've said this weekend. First of all, this con is not family oriented.
We're done with the show. Anyways, for Chris,
this has been our whole weekend.
Yes.
For
Chris D'Onofrio, Tom Molina, and Krissy Lawlor, I am Ernie Layug with the Fans POV at DragonCon, and we will end. Good night.
I'm gonna sleep now. Good
night. They're saying good night. Anyways, so for our final montage, we will take Atlanta. Shut up, Chris. We will have music. We'll have sights and sounds from DragonCon set to music from Atlanta's own Emma Rose. What are they be singing, Krissy?
Donald McGillifrey.
Thank you. We'll see you.
On this one, take this on home, folks. This one's called Donald McGillifrey.
We'll be joined by LT Manzarella here on the stage.
Over there, stop by and get a bumper sticker. Come say hello. Look us up on Facebook. We'll see you on the web. Have a good one.